Hello and welcome to Back to the Feature, the show where we talk about movies past, present, and future. Today, we're doing, as promised, our spoiler review for Rogue One, A Star Wars Story. I always go for that Star Wars first, and then the Rogue One, I remember the actual title. Rogue One, A Star Wars Story. We're really excited to talk about this one today. Yeah. We're big Star Wars fans, been big Star Wars fans since we were kids. And this is definitely one that's getting a lot of discussion right now. So I think we were kind of chomping at the bit to be able to really get into the nitty gritty. So you guys have been warned. It's spoilers. It should be in the title as well. But from here on out, we are going to spoil Rogue One. 3, 2, 1. You're in a spoiler zone now, everybody.
Man, that Darth Vader scene at the end. Oh my gosh.
I almost wanted to shout, everyone dies. But... Well, they do. But as we said in our non-spoiler review, I really enjoyed this movie. I really enjoyed the tone inside of the Star Wars universe. The fact that it's really more of a war movie than it is a sci-fi movie. And definitely, I mean, darker than what we've seen from the other saga movies, which I like because it really separates it from that.
Yeah, I think, well, a lot of people, there's some of the really positive reviews that this movie's getting is it's comparing its darkness to that of... The Empire Strikes Back.
Yeah.
Which, I would say that. This movie blew me away. I didn't really know what we were going to get. You know, you always have your assumptions walking into a movie, which you really got to guard yourself with, I think. Because I think a lot of people walked into this movie thinking it was going to be something that it wasn't.
Yeah.
And they walked out of it, you know, with polarizing
thoughts. I really think you should never walk into a movie with a bunch of expectations of the movie in your head.
Yep.
You have to kind of look at what you're being presented and try to look at that critically. Instead of just kind of going like, well, I wanted this movie. I think I benefited from, as soon as I saw the promotional stuff for this and the trailers for this, it felt like the Dirty Dozen, Magnificent Seven Samurai, but done in the Star Wars world. So I think I was kind of ready for the end result. I think I was even saying it when we did our podcast version talking about this months ago, that I was like, I think everyone's going to die.
Yeah.
So I wasn't totally surprised. If anything, I was a little satisfied in my own rightness for a minute. I was like, as they're being blown to pieces, I'm just like, I was right. But it definitely was giving off that vibe, though. So I don't feel like any of the trailers were lying to anybody as far as what this movie was going to be like. I think the biggest surprise is all the shots that didn't, from the trailers, that didn't make it into the movie, which I think definitely kind of shows that there was some reshoots here, but end result, I don't think there's too much to complain
about. I don't have any complaints, really, and honestly, you know, I can't really tell exactly where the reshoots were. I mean, a lot of people are probably guessing the Vader at the end.
That's, you know, looking at it for me.
Do we really know? Is that actually a reshoot? We don't know.
Yeah, I mean, there's no way for us to know. I mean, none of us worked on the film, and we can't sit here and go, well, that's obviously a reshoot. I mean, we don't know. I think some things do feel a little bit more like reshoots than others. I think that you have to wonder, as far as the reshoot thing goes, in the end of the movie, is the geography of the scene. And you look at that, and I was kind of looking at that again, the image of the AT-ATs firing, and the kind of that POV from them running across the beach.
She's holding
the drive, so you kind of have to wonder about what maybe the original idea was for, maybe how they were either going to deliver that, or maybe that's what changed, because they didn't have to cross the beach.
Yeah.
It was all pretty much for them in the same area of the facility that when they go with K2SO to get the actual file out of the archives there. You know, with the... Actually, I kind of really liked a little bit of that, too.
Yeah. Then again, though, that might not have been reshoots, because that type of film, that's how people make films. You film, like, tons of scenes, and then you go into editing.
Mm-hmm.
And that type of stuff gets worked out in the editing studio. So, I mean, we don't really know if that really was the reshoots.
Yeah.
I mean, we won't know. And it doesn't matter.
No, I don't think it matters. I think that people are focusing, I think, a little too much on the fact that there were reshoots and not looking at, like, the actual movie itself. I think that when you go in and go like, well, this is a reshot scene, so there must be something wrong with it, you're automatically going to be looking at that movie, I think, in a really weird and wrong light, instead of just going, how does this fit in the story? Does it fit in the story? Which I think that for the most part, it does. I think that's the big thing, and we'll start diving into some of the things I think we're seeing as being the consistent issues is the fan service issue.
Yeah.
I feel like it's coming up a lot with this movie that, oh, it's just fan service. Like, its existence, apparently, to a lot of people is fan service. And I don't know. I really have to disagree. I think the only things from the movie that I felt like maybe they didn't need and they were leaning toward fan service was Buttface and Walrus Guy bumping yeah. into them. And then the R2-D2 C-3PO. And it's because they weren't needed. You know what I mean?
No.
They weren't needed.
In fact, they probably bring up continuity issues.
Yeah.
I mean, there's like some off things about them being in the location
yeah.
they are. So
but then again, though, in a universe where, you know, you can travel at the speed of light.
Yeah.
Is it really? You know what
is
I mean? If they
really,
were there
yeah.
for 5 minutes, couldn't you catch up? I mean, I'm not an expert. It's really hard to say, you know what I mean? As far as the logistics of, like, moving around the universe in Star Wars, I'm not Einstein or Tesla, so I can't really tell you, you know, how that is supposed to work, so...
Another thing that keeps getting brought up, well, I just want to say, too, I thought that Grandma Tarkin's character, the motion capture character that they included in this film, was jaw-dropping.
Yeah, you know, I've heard tons of criticism for it. So far, and honestly, though, like,
that's one of my favorite parts in the movie. When you see his reflection on the glass, and you're kind of like, okay, wait a second, and he turns around, I was like jaw on the floor. I was like, holy crap, I didn't know he was going to be in this film, because it's not listed on IMDb as a
yeah.
character, you know? And I thought the CGI was just, I couldn't even believe that was
yeah,
in the film.
It's not perfect. And I think a lot of people are going, well, it's not perfect, so it shouldn't exist,
yeah.
and it's bad. But it is the best we have ever seen that done. Like, bar none. It made the stuff in Civil War with young Tony Stark look like a joke. It looked
yeah.
like the young Michael Douglas stuff did not... There's so many lines in that where you can tell that it's not real. It's funny, I'm just listing Marvel movies. You know, and even in something like Captain America the Winter Soldier with Agent Carter when he's visiting her in the hospital, like, and they've aged her up, you can tell.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That is what that is. Where this Tarkin was, I mean, it was so close. It's better
yeah.
than, I didn't think that we could make it look that good. So I really can't criticize it too much. And I think anybody that knows anything, too, about Star Wars, big fans of Star Wars, know that it was completely necessary.
It's important
for Tarkin to be involved in this story. Okay, he's not just there for nostalgia, but like, and I know that's one of those things too that people are always kind of wishy-washy about. Like, well, if it's just for the fans, then you know what I mean. Then it shouldn't be in the movie. It's like, well, who do you think's watching a Star Wars movie? I mean, some of them are going to be fans.
Yeah.
But like I said, beyond that, it's one of those things that, like I said, he is completely necessary in the story. Like I said, where it's not fan service, and it did look great.
Yeah.
It did legitimately look great.
I think people probably expected Orson Krennic's Ben Mendelsohn's character to be a little more prominent.
And I would say
film.
That he was a little thin. He was a little weak for my taste, too.
But the inclusion of Tarkin... I think solidified that. I enjoyed that aspect of the film. I really enjoyed that he was in this film.
I kind of like that little bit of that dynamic, though, where it was, you kind of saw the boys club between, like, Tarkin and Vader. Like, you kind of see
him
get, pushed to the wayside.
Yep.
And you see how these guys kind of solidify themselves inside the new regime with Death Star at their beck and call. I think that does have some value, and I think that was really interesting to kind of get to see. If he thinks he's like Vader's gonna be able to like kind of sway it to his side and finds out, no, Tarkin's his boy. You
yeah.
know? So I thought that was interesting, the power struggle within the Empire that we're getting to see. The one though that I'll say that didn't quite look as good was the Leia. Didn't
but it's
quite
so
look
brief.
As good.
It's
yeah.
so brief though. And honestly, I as soon as she turned around, I just felt like magic. I don't really know any other way to put it. It's just kind of like, I want to go home right now and put in A New Hope.
Yeah, this movie definitely gets you there. Gets you to that point.
That's all I wanted to do. It's all I've been thinking about is watching the original trilogy. I haven't done it yet. I haven't had time. But it's all I can think about is Star Wars right now. And I think Rogue One has accomplished something massive in that respect.
No, yeah, I think it's getting a lot, I think, of unfair criticism.
It's getting a lot of positive criticism, though,
yeah,
too.
No, totally,
we don't want to be too dour here.
Totally.
I mean, this movie is getting a lot of love, especially from us.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, one of the big things that keeps coming up is the characters. I think it's a really interesting cast of characters. Obviously, very diverse cast of characters. You've Jyn Erso, Captain Cassian Andor, K2SO, Base Maribus, Chirrut Imwe, and Bodhi, the pilot, plays by Riz Ahmed. You know, it's kind of our, like I said, our little dirty half dozen here. For this film, I really enjoyed the way that they handled the characters in this movie. Not everybody did. They didn't feel like they got to know enough about them, but I think that they honestly did some really great, subtle character work. You know, I think the big thing I always keep hearing is like, well, we didn't get to know enough about them, but I kind of like that they let these people kind of stand on their own. It's like, when you meet someone in real life, they don't just walk up to you, I'm so-and-so from such-and-such, and, you know, this is my whole backstory, and this is why you care now. Where they kind of let the movie show instead of tell. You see by their actions, you see by the choices they make, and the way they respond to the people around them, you get to learn about their characters. And also, too, with Star Wars, it's like, even though all these characters don't make it out of this movie, something tells me that there's going to be other properties where you're going to have that outlet. If you're like, I really was curious about like this character, and you can delve into it, that outlet's going to be there for you if you really were like,
we're going to get tons of Star Wars movies.
Mm-hmm.
Especially this one doing as well as it is, being the first anthology movie, Disney has got it now.
Mm-hmm. And then even then, I think, though, like, even if the characters, like as far as their backstories or whatever it was that wasn't quite as compelling, I think that even the idea for a lot of these ones are really interesting ideas. Like, the one I keep thinking about personally is Cassian Andor. And, you know, we don't get tons from this guy, but I think that Diego Luna does a great job of just sort of showing you by the choices he has to make and the way that he responds to things. He's a really interesting representation of the rebellion that we've never seen before. We've never seen this person who has to work in the dark, work in the gray, and do these things that are morally unsound.
Well, I think it brings realism to the rebellion as well.
Exactly, and we've never gotten to see it from that angle, so I think that just like the role that his character fulfills in the story and like what he's saying, what his character is saying about the rebellion as a whole, I think has tons of value.
I think it personalizes the rebellion. I know we mentioned it in our, you know, spoiler-free review. We compared this to like Saving Private Ryan.
Mm-hmm.
No, this movie is not Saving Private Ryan. It doesn't play out like Saving Private Ryan, but it does play out like a war film, and we use Saving Private Ryan because it's a war film.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's seen. How are characters introduced in war films? Do you get a lot of, I mean, like Hacksaw Ridge, yes, you get a backstory, it's a biopic.
Yeah.
But a lot of, most war films, you get put right into the combat and these characters are learning to, you know, interact with each other as the movie progresses. We mentioned Barry Pepper.
Yeah.
From
Everyone loves
Barry Pepper. He's such a great character.
If I were to ask you to name the top three characters from Saving Private Ryan, you go Tom Hanks. And then some people would say Matt Damon because they love Matt Damon, even though he wasn't that great in that movie. And then they get to Barry Pepper. It's like the number, the obvious number three.
Yeah, you remember it,
like,
you remember it. Even Vin Diesel's death in that movie was good.
Yeah.
And there's like, you don't know anything about him.
It's because of what it was trying to represent about World War II, about, you know, being a soldier in a faraway land. How much of it is Barry Pepper, like, making an impact? It's just because he's a badass with a sniper rifle, and he quotes cool scripture lines, okay? He's like Jules from Pulp Fiction with a sniper rifle and less Jerry curls, okay? And, you know, so it's like, how much of that is the goodwill of just, like, this character's a badass? And, you know what I mean? So you kind of give them a pass.
Yeah.
Where I feel like these characters did have a lot to say about the Star Wars universe. Like, I think Baze and Chirrut are a great example.
I love that relationship.
I think those guys honestly get the MVP a little bit because I think they sold that relationship with very little.
Yeah, well, and I think, well, the, you know, some of the stuff of the Force is being played through with those two characters too because they were the guards
of
the Jedi of the Jedi Temple on Jedha. So I really love the interaction between them. And people saying that the character development in this is weak, I'm not seeing
that. I feel like you really need to pay attention and really think about why characters are doing, saying, and making the choices they're making. And I think that you'll realize that this the characters in this movie do have a lot of depth. Just because they're not really showy about it, you know what I mean, doesn't mean that there's not some great character work, character development going on here. I think Bass and Chirrut, I think there's a lot of character development going on right there. Oh, really, look at Cassian's journey. I mean, really, I think the him choosing not to kill Galen, they go to Edo, they go to this Imperial outpost, because that's where they find out that Galen is. And Cassian has to make, he gets orders that he has to, like, kill him. But yeah, like, I think that it's such a turning point for the character. I mean, and we do get to learn a little bit of about his past, but, you know, really from there, I think it's a huge focal point for him, where he chooses to disobey that order. And I think it's a huge part of the reasons why he then shows up with all those guys. Like, we've had to do all these things for this rebellion. We want something to really believe in. And they're inspired by Jin, which I actually think she's actually an inspiring character. You know, and that's what really the story is about. It's about the people that inspired the rebellion to even be a thing.
It's the this movie is the opening crawl to A New Hope. Like, we finally get to find out, like, what happened. This movie is extremely exciting, too. We've been just gushing about the special effects in this film. And I even said it on my Twitter. I was like, this is like, one of the most exciting third acts of any film, like, I've seen.
Yeah.
I mean, it may be not the best, but, I mean, it's up there. It is up there with just spectacular.
It's, you know, watching the second time, I will definitely say that the third act is extremely good. It takes a little bit to get there, though. Like, watching the second time when everything isn't brand new, it does take a little bit, you know what I mean, as far as to get there. It's a little slow burn, but that third act, though.
Oh, my gosh.
And it doesn't fall into the same, like, trap that I think a lot of movies do, where it's tiresome to watch this long, huge battle, and you're like, you're like exhausted from it. You know what I mean? Like, your shell
shot. Like the end of Man of Steel.
Yeah. You're just like that.
Just seeing the same thing over and over again. Yeah. This does not do that.
Yeah, this doesn't do that, where you're really the whole time. Honestly, I think the second time I watched it, I was like, was it that short the first time? I could have had more of that. It was so good. And in a lot of ways, I mean, just talking from the technical standpoint, it could be the best Star Wars battle put on film.
Yeah.
You know, when you look at the tone of it, the things that they're able to do with it.
Well, I think hands down, you could almost say Gareth Edwards, his direction in this film, it might be the best directed, it might be the best shot film in the series. Cinematography, direction, art design, like what it looked like and felt like, this movie is master class.
Yeah, it's a world that feels lived in and real. And I think they make such great use of the costumes and locations. You really get the sense of this being an actual war, an actual battle.
Stormtroopers, like, actually felt like soldiers. I know we got that in The Force Awakens a little bit with Finn and some of the earlier stuff, with the village that they, you know, kill everyone. It's mostly Finn, though.
TR-8R, too.
Yeah. Traitor! But whereas this film, like, it actually is, it's directed, it's filmed, and it feels like when they're in Jeddah and they're walking through and he says, like, this place is about to blow, like, that's why, like, just the atmosphere and the feel of it, it actually felt war, it actually felt like the stormtroopers were actual soldiers in this, you know, in
they
the scene.
They even hit things with their guns.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Blasters, I mean, don't tear me apart in the comments for that. Blasters.
But yeah, no, this movie is exciting all the way through. I love, like, there's a lot of edgier sequences. That fight scene with Chirrut. I mean.
Oh, yeah. I think that's really cool how, like, the style gets changed up. And
yeah, I love the way they filmed it. Yeah.
Flick for, like, a second. I would question a little bit, like, how you take out. This must be some shitty armor if he's using that stick. He's getting work done with that stick.
That's true. Well, we don't know the dynamics. They're not blocking lead bullets or blocking glass or what kind of, you know.
Yeah.
You know, what are their shields supposed to be doing? You know, blocking lasers. So, the design there. We could rabbit trail on that for like hours,
it's,
right?
It's still cool, though.
Yeah,
it was still cool. But yeah, no, I really love the tone of this film and the way that it was done. And it's immersive quality the way that he shot it. I think it's really an important part of it. The experience of the film is Gareth Edwards' direction.
I think going into the direction too, one of my favorite things seeing in the third act, you know, was seeing the AT-ATs, and I think we've seen this style from Gareth Edwards in 2014's Godzilla.
Yeah.
But it's the scale. How he contrasts and shows scale. I loved when the AT-ATs first show up. And, like, the feeling of, like, you know, oh, shit. You know, like, that dread that you feel.
Yeah.
It's coming out of the fog. That shot is amazing. Something I'll never forget.
I love, and it's funny because in that little moment
like
when they first
up.
Show up. Well, I love that Chirrut, like, you can hear him, like, listening. Like, he's just like, what the fuck is that? Like, he can just hear it, like, coming. And then, like, gets Bates' attention, like, run. We gotta run now. I thought that was really cool. I love they did a few things with him like that, with his blindness, where they played it really well. Like, I loved, in that first scene with the stick fight, when he's done, and then those other guys come in, you see him, like, trying to get a sense of what he's hearing. You know, there's that little moment where he goes the wrong way and then thinks, and okay, it's over here. I really, really liked how they did that. With his blindness,
some of his
senses.
Some of the early reviews I heard too, they were talking about them being like comic relief. I watched a review on YouTube.
They've got a little bit of that old married couple thing.
Yeah, a little bit, but it's not. I mean,
no.
I mean, this at the end, like the redemption.
What you feel
with those two characters and their relationship, and just the climax of Chirrut's character. Like the whole time, he is force sensitive. Obviously, he's force sensitive. The Force used him to go turn the Force shield off so that the rebellion would prevail.
You know, it's funny because that scene has so much impact if you're paying more attention to it, because they, you know, earlier in the movie when they're in the prison is actually where you get some of the backstory with Baze, and he talks about. Because he's praying. He's making fun of Chirrut for praying to try to get the door open. I can think of where there's some of that funny thing. Like I said, where they kind of have that old married couple thing, where they're really close friends, and you know, he's like, oh, you know, you're silly. You think that the Force is a thing, and you know, like, oh, you're blind because you won't look at it anymore. But Chirrut he makes a comment at Baze that, or to them, he's like, Baze, you know, he makes it at him, but he kind of says it for the room, but it's just like, you know, he used to be the most devoted of all of, like, of the Wills, you know? And so we do learn that Baze is a guy that has, something has rocked his faith. That he doesn't view it the same way. And when you get to that final scene with him and Chirrut, it's him finally seeing it again. You know, it's like Mel Gibson's story in Signs just kind of condensed down into a little bit less. But it's like, if you look for it,
It's
there.
Yeah, it's there.
It is there. But you really have to be kind of listening and paying attention to the movie. And I kind of felt like that the first time I walked out, where like I felt the character work was there. It was just kind of really subtly woven, and they just kind of show you. And just if you think and listen about what it's showing you, there really is some excellent things about these characters. Like I said, about like Cassian, there's some excellent things with Baze and Chirrut.
Yes, you're not. I mean, it's obvious. It's a singular story. Yes, it's a prequel to the original trilogy, and now going further into episodes 7 through 9. But this is a standalone. These characters are standalone. You're not going to get 6 films of Luke Skywalker to like make a point.
Exactly, and that's
you're not
going to
get
think about
3 films of Vader to finally get to the Return of the Jedi redemption.
And you're not setting up a character like Rey and Finn and Poe, these guys that are going to be going forward in your trilogy. I almost wonder if some of that was purposeful, where they didn't want you to get too attached. Because, I mean, at the end of the day, it is a Disney movie. It is a Star Wars movie. You know what I mean? And I wonder about some of those reshoots that maybe Gareth Edwards made this movie's ending a little bit darker than like what they thought it was going to be. Like, I almost wonder, right? So we were talking earlier about the AT-AT shot, about them running across. I almost wonder if, like, that is, like, a huge kind of part of the suicide part of the mission. Like, a bunch of them just get gunned down by the AT-ATs trying to get across from it. It would be very dark. I mean, apparently nuclear explosions are less dark, but, you know what I mean? There's not the kind of the physical, more visceral, you know what I mean? It's like, oh, there's a flash and they're gone. Not something like, oh my god, they were all like gunned down in cold blood in front of us. Oh, the humanity! you know what I mean? Like, I almost wonder if they didn't want you to get too like, oh my gosh, this is my favorite character in all of Star Wars. Oh, she just blew up. You know what I mean? I kind of think that some of that may have been slightly, like, on purpose.
Yeah, if you're going to kill a bunch of them, show Vader doing it.
Mm-hmm. I wonder if they really tried to make these characters represent things in the Star Wars universe more than being like, this is Rey, you're going to follow her for 3 movies. You better fucking like her.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
Like, yeah. You know, yeah, I kind of, like I said, this is definitely more plot and story-driven film than, say, something like Force Awakens, which I think lacked on story and plot, but did an excellent job with its character work. It's setting up its character for future movies.
You get Harrison Ford back. You get the Han Solo that you've been waiting for 25 years. Mm. You know, it has benefits like that. I think this is maybe even this was the harder movie to film, direct, to pull off, and to pull off in a positive way. So, I mean, mad props to Gareth Edwards. This movie is even more impressive than I thought it was going to be.
Yeah, and as much of it is familiar, there's enough honest, real swings into new territory to honestly get you more interested.
I really like that they expanded on the lore in this film as well. We finally find out what powers the Death Star, what makes it so destructive, and its kyber crystals.
I think this is important stuff. The kyber crystal stuff, and I think some people have specifically asked me about this, like, that I've seen, who's gotten to see the movie, like, what's the kyber crystal stuff? I think that they're setting this up. I think this is going to link into Force Awakens. They're doing so much of the kyber crystals on stuff like Star Wars Rebels. They've shown them on clones. Sith holocrons are now back in canon. And now they're making this point of going, like, you know, the Death Star? Basically a giant lightsaber with some housing attached to it. You know what I mean? And I think that that's... They're really pushing that. We're seeing Jedha. We see that a Jedi planet like Jedha was filled with kyber crystals, and maybe they have some link to the Force. Look at the title, The Force Awakens. Well, the thing woke up. We're probably going to learn some more about the inner workings of the Force. Hopefully it's not more space bugs like midichlorians.
What was all that with the lightsaber opening in the box and Rey's whole dream
sequence
that she has?
Exactly. I think that the kyber crystals are going to be intrinsically linked with the Force, and we're going to find out a lot more about that specific thing. So I think that actually the kyber crystal part of this movie has value for the movies going forward.
Another thing that I really enjoyed about the movie is it finally fixed the plot hole in A New Hope.
Yeah.
The Death Star was designed to have a flaw. So I enjoyed that. A lot of people were like, oh, it's fan service. You know, you had to fix a plot hole from the original, which is a classic. And that's fan service. It's continuity.
Yeah.
It makes sense. Like, why not add that in if you're making this movie? Why not put that there?
Yeah.
It just fixes it. It strengthens
A
New Hope in my mind. I mean,
it makes the whole struggle, the whole war, a little more interesting, honestly. Like I said, now we're actually getting to see, not every rebel was this clean, squeaky clean good guy. And not every person that was working in the Empire was like, these guys got the right idea. You know what I mean? That it just like with any evil regime, there are people within it that don't believe in the crazy radical crap that they're doing.
Yeah, no, speaking of radical, though, you know, Saw Gerrera, I thought he was an interesting character in this film, too.
You got a heavy hitter like Forrest Whitaker.
Yeah, powerful
performance
by Forrest Whitaker. I heard people say he was overacting. It's, oh my gosh.
People that don't know how to act. I mean, I
he was pointless in the movie!
I don't think that. I think that they did a really awesome job of actually linking Jin to
him.
And, yeah.
Because
yeah.
he's decrepit! Because he barely can walk! That's why he didn't escape.
Did you not see the whole breathing apparatus?
He was
no
like
legs
10
thing.
Minutes from death! Already, might as well go out on Jet. I mean, like, seriously.
Yeah, yeah. I know, I think I definitely believed him when he said, you know, I'm not going to run anymore. You know, you look at that dude, and this is another one of those things that, you know, people can argue with me about, like, well, you shouldn't have to watch Clones to understand this, to watch the Clone Wars series, but, you know, it's one of those things where it's like, okay, we've heard about this character before, and there's stuff about him in the continuity and in canon in Star Wars, and if you look at where he started, and then you see this, where he is with his body now, like all of the things that it cost him being this character, you know what I mean, and waging this, you know, like I said, really radical style of, you know, rebellion, how much it's cost him. I like the parallel that he's like almost Vader, like he's almost Vader, and like I said, so it's just like, I can see where that guy would be like, I'm done.
I'll be a martyr.
This is the last time I'm getting blown up. You know,
yeah.
Like, you know what? I'm done with this whole getting blown up shit.
And we,
you know,
and
let's
we,
just
yeah,
end
and
it.
We would guess that he would die because he's not in A New Hope,
right?
So it makes sense. But yeah, no, like we didn't even talk about K2SO. I mean, we gushed a little.
Oh
bit
yeah, we'll save him the last because
yeah,
I'm
but
just
like, oh, there was such an awesome. He was so awesome in this movie. Such a great new addition to, of a droid in Star Wars.
I will say this right now. my favorite droid. We are all K2SO in some way. All of us. Well, everything he says, I'm just like, it's what I would be if I was a droid.
Yeah.
That's how I'd be. I love his line where they're just like, we get pulled into like the cold vacuum of space, you know, and he's just like, I won't.
Yeah.
I'll live. He doesn't need to breathe. I love that. Just his whole personality, just basically, he says anything that comes into his circuits. Cassian has reprogrammed him to now be a friendly, instead of...
Somewhat friendly.
Somewhat friendly, I mean, yeah.
Congratulations!
Friendly's a loose word. He's there. He's on their team. I love that, too, after, like, the inspiring, like, everyone's gonna come with you. He's like, I'll go with you, Jin. Because Cassian told me I had to. Like, that stuff just... Just excellent. Favorite droid in any Star Wars movie. He's the anti-C-3PO.
Yeah.
Or he's R2-D2 with a voice. But honestly, Alan Tudyk, such an amazing voice actor. The man is a leaf on the wind. And I feel so great for him because he's one of those guys I've just always really liked him.
Yeah.
And I mean,
no,
he already has iconic roles. He does. But... It's awesome to see him be, like, the star a little bit of the show. He's kind of the MVP of this movie.
Yeah, well...
I think for the general audience, like, he's Rocket and Groot, like, smashed into one character a little bit.
Yeah, and his death was very meaningful and important.
I felt pain inside when he died.
I know!
I was like, don't you take him so quick! You know, and the thing, people watch the movie, you're like, oh, I don't feel anything. I'm just like... Dude, I was, like, straight up emotional when K2SO died. That guy was turning into my spirit animal, you know?
Yes.
So it was hard to let him go. And honestly, the way he sacrifices himself for them, they're trying to get the plans out of the archive weird gaming majiggy thing. And he locks them in there. They got all these stormtroopers. I love he finally gets his gun, too. And he's just, like, holding off all these stormtroopers while trying to help them. And it's like, he knows he's going to die. And I think you start to really progressively... I like how they kind of ease you into that, in that way, with death. Where, you know what I mean? It's like, you see him getting hit. And then you're like, well, maybe he'll live. Maybe he'll live. And you start seeing him get hit other places. And you're like, oh, shit.
Yeah,
and
the music starts amping up a little bit.
Yeah, and so I think that was a good way to do that first death, where it's not really sudden. It's just kind of like, you're kind of like dipping you in the pool with this whole everyone's going to die shit.
Yup.
You know who we really didn't mention? We talk about K2SO, which we don't need to talk about the merits of K2SO. I think everybody who watches the movie is going to in some way like him. If you don't, yell at me in the comments how wrong I am about everything. But one of the people I really like Riz Ahmed as Bodhi the pilot.
Oh, yeah. I thought his death was really meaningful, too. It really hit me.
Yeah.
When the grenade comes flying into the vehicle and...
Well, one of the dynamics they showed with him early on that I really enjoyed was how when he first gets to Saw Gerrera's and they've got him all, like, in the hood and everything like that, and the guy who's talking to Saw is like, oh, we captured him and we took this from him. He's like, no, I gave that to them, and you know what I mean? Like, where he's like, hey, come on, look past the Imperial uniform. I'm just a person. I'm trying to help. And you really, I think, in that way, you really feel bad for that guy. Where it's like, you see that kind of, and again, it's examining ideas about war and introducing them in the Star Wars about this guy trying to defect. And I think what would happen to a lot of actual defectors in real life, you won't maybe have, like, a tentacle monster, like, do weird porn things to you, but, you know... In general, I think that moment, I really, really like that moment where he's like, no, you didn't take that from me. I gave that to you. I'm trying to help you. Please listen.
Well, yeah, I mean, you want to throw comparisons back to, like, World War II. I mean, imagine if a Nazi, like, would do that.
Yeah.
I mean, they gunned him down.
Yeah. Yeah. And where he's really, like, he's begging for his life. He's just begging for any kind of, like, please just listen.
Yeah.
I really like that. And it kind of got me on board a little bit with his character. Where, and I like, too, that he's just kind of a normal guy. He's like a you know, shipping pilot. He's like the UPS guy of the Empire. You know what I mean? He's not, like, some warrior.
Yeah.
You know, it's just, he listened to Galen, was inspired by Galen, which apparently these Ursos are just really inspiring motherfuckers. But, you know, he's inspired by him to go and defect. I think that it's a really interesting, another interesting angle to look at Star Wars in that light. I know a lot of people are like, well, where's the whimsy and stuff? But honestly, for me as an adult viewer...
This film wasn't supposed to be whimsy.
Yeah.
This film just wasn't supposed to be
It was nice to see them go, like, this is a legitimate war. How will the logistics of this work? So that element of Bodhi's character I thought was really interesting. Then he does lose his mind for a little bit. There's the... I don't even remember the name of the thing. And this is one of the things, actually, one of those things about Star Wars that I'd like to bring up a little bit, is when did we determine... that there had to be some sort of creature feature scene in every single Star Wars. Like, you know, we've got the Wampa in Strikes Back, we've got the Rancor and the Sarlacc Pit. Trying to think of A New Hope, if there is some sort of, like, oh, wow, that crazy monster we got introduced to. Because now Force Awakens did it, and now this movie did it, where they're kind of, like, shoehorning in a little bit. Like, I didn't mind this one too much, but it was kind of like, didn't need that. You know, the weird things from Force Awakens were that, because that was like the least Star Warsy part of the Force Awakens was that.
Yeah. Just in a way. You get a little Han. You just get Harrison Ford Han Solo and making quips and
yeah.
And just being fun, seeing his everyday job.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, like I don't know which sect of Star Wars fans have determined that this is required, like. I get the, you know, I got a bad feeling about this. Yep. Need that. That's one of those ones. Like, that's why I heard some people groaning a little bit with that one. I'm like, that's one of those ones.
Come on, go to a movie, have some fun, guys.
I feel like that one's sacred.
You gotta have that.
But yeah, so he loses his mind temporarily. Which, I mean, Saw never really said, like, you lose your mind. But, you know, he never said, like, that's a little Bane, actually, from Dark Knight Rises. But yeah, I really enjoyed Riz Ahmed's performance. I think he did a lot with a lot of these actors.
I love the ensemble cast. Mm-hmm. I love what the cast represented. I love what the cast went through in the film. I think just the arc of the character. And I think another thing too, you know, I mean, some of it is supposed to be a little separated because these are the rebels.
Yeah.
You know, if you put too much character into one of these people, it's not going to work.
Yeah.
It's not going to work.
Like I said earlier, I think a lot of them were meant to be representations
of the rebellion.
That or the Star Wars universe, you know, showing these two guardians of the Kyber, showing a rebel spy, that would look like, and someone, like I said, the dirtier side of the rebellion.
You got the defector, he's got a guy trying to get out of...
And then a really interesting character in Jyn Erso, who is just kind of this person caught in the middle and not knowing really at the beginning of this movie which side to fall on. So John, what did you think then about Jyn Erso then as our main character?
I thought she was written really well, especially with, you know, her dad being the one that designed the Death Star, her relationship with Saw Gerrera, her being an orphan in the Star Wars world.
I really like that they did that with her, that there was more reason for her to be involved than just like, well, your daddy made it. And when I saw the trailers, I was sort of like, I'm like, I get it a little bit, but at the same time, I'm like, anyone could do that mission. You don't have to be someone's relative to go find him. Like, why would she know where he is? You know what I mean? She probably hasn't talked to the guy forever. So I kind of like that they gave more justification for why they needed Jyn specifically. You know what I mean?
Yep.
To get Saw. To do any of this.
Yep. And I think that's an amazing scene between Forrest Whitaker and Felicity Jones.
Best scene in the movie. That whole section of the movie, I think, is the best part of the movie.
Yeah.
She actually meets Saw Gerrera. We find out that she was with him from the time that he finds her when she's a kid after her parents. Well, her one parent is murdered at the beginning of the movie. It's very Inglourious Bastards. She's murdered in the beginning of the movie, and then her father is taken. And she goes and hides in this, and she's found by Saw Gerrera, so the movie opens. And you find out that from that age to about 16, she was with these extremist rebels, and which is interesting because you're able to kind of paint a little bit of the picture of this girl's struggle through, you know, all these years in between the scene we saw at the beginning and where she is now. And as I said, it's all these little things informing it. And then what comes right after that with seeing the hologram, her dad, and I think it's just the two best performances, the three really, like I said, the whole sequence from beginning to end there. Are the kind of the three best performances, but man, they knock it out of the park with that, because you then get to see on Jyn's face finally the release of all of this baggage that she's had about her dad and about how she's led her life is based off what she thought that he did. And at the same time, you have Mads Mikkelsen performing a total other scene in a different room, and dude's just killing it. You get the same thing, basically, with Galen's character. And it's such a cathartic moment for characters that you, like I said, I think that, you know, you get to fill in so much about Jin by seeing how she reacts to that hologram of her dad. It says so much more than any bunches of exposition could have ever done. No, I think it's an incredibly important scene. You know, we talked earlier about Jin being this person that inspires the other rebels to rebel. And I don't think she can get there without that scene. And she has an interesting conversation right before with Saw Gerrera, where he asks her, you know, can you live with seeing Imperial flags flying above you? And I think she responds with something that, you know, well, you know, it doesn't do anything if you don't look up.
Yeah.
But I think it's such an interesting journey from her, from being someone that just doesn't care. That is just like, I don't want anything to do with your war, either side of you. When she gets busted out by the rebels, she like beats the rebels and tries to run away until K2SO chokeslams her like a boss. But yeah, I think it's a really interesting moment for her where, like I said, she kind of realizes this thing that she's been fighting up against her whole life, she's free from it. And then she's free to really inspire these people to do this great thing. And I think that's overall what this movie really is about and what is important about it. It's showing you the origins of the rebellion. These are the heroes. These are the legends.
It's the first win.
That inspired the rebellion to even keep existing. And I think that's why it's such an important little chapter in Star Wars. We're getting to finally get a little peek behind the curtain of one of the most important organizations in the entire, you know, saga.
Yeah.
Is the rebellion, and we've never really got to explore them. I mean, with the Empire as villains, we get to explore them quite deeply. We've never got to go, like, what are these good guys all about? Where do they come from? What? Why are they doing the things they're doing?
Mm-hmm.
Why do they believe that they can even fight this
yeah,
enormous
thing? And that's
thing.
The thing I was talking to you about, too. You know, the prequels are canon, but they don't help with anything. Explain that, because episode 4, you know, it's the first one. It starts out, it's episode 4. It's the first thing. What happened right before that? I want to know.
Mm-hmm.
And the prequels don't give you any of that.
Yeah, I think that's one of the most interesting time periods and one of the most freeing time periods that you can play with, I think, in the Star Wars continuity is really everything that happens between 3 and 4. There's probably a gold mine of different stories there.
I was saying they could make 3-4 movies. Easy.
Oh, yeah, about different things. I mean, it could be totally unrelated things, too.
Mm-hmm.
They could go really far away from just the saga films.
I'll be fine with it.
that and the In Between A New Hope and Empire Strikes Back is also an extremely interesting. I'd love to see maybe a little something like that. But though that would be tougher because obviously you're going to have to involve a lot more of the characters.
Yeah.
But no, I think this movie definitely satisfied what I really wanted to get. I really wanted to get a darker, more of a war film. Bring a little bit of the realism of war into the Star Wars universe. Where it doesn't, you know what I mean? Like, kind of getting, not rid of some of the camp, but just trying to look at it in a more realistic way.
It's not just Han Solo running through. I love Han Solo.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love Han Solo, but you know what I mean?
Yeah, this isn't a swashbuckling movie where that's what the Star Wars other movies are, where they are a little bit more of a swashbuckling adventure, where this is kind of a more serious war movie.
Mm-hmm.
I really like that. I kind of really wanted that. From this.
So then going through to, you know, you've seen it a second time. Now I've only seen it once yet. But, you know, we originally settled with giving this film an A.
Mm-hmm.
Now I know we had a little more discussion about it.
Yeah, I cooled a little bit with it on the second viewing. But not too much. I'd say like an A-.
Yeah.
The movie has flaws. Like I was saying earlier, I think that the third act is really, really strong. It takes a little bit to get there, but there's honestly, for me, there's a lot of interesting things, but I can see where most audiences would go, like, okay, it takes a little bit.
It takes a little bit
to get up to speed. When it does, thing hits really hard. There was two of the things that have been deemed fan service that I think are legitimate fan service. That, like I said, it's Buttface and Walrus Man, and C-3PO and R2 didn't need to be there.
No.
Like, that was just... We didn't quite need there, but I thought that Tarkin, Bail Organa, all the different ships they used.
Yeah.
They were all necessary. They're all necessary for telling the story. And then, too, like, the little footage of, like, Red Leader and Gold Leader. It's like, come on! That's awesome! Like, and honestly, it's not intrusive. It's not like someone who's... I didn't even notice in the first time I watched it. Honestly. I didn't even notice because I wasn't even thinking they were even supposed to... That they were even going to do that. I was just like, oh, cool. Like, I didn't notice that Red 5 went down on the first try. I was like, oh, there's a call sign. That was a spot open. I think I know a guy. But yeah, like, you know, you get those things. I honestly didn't notice it on the first time. And then, too, there are the new things that they introduced in here. Which is funny because I don't think anyone will even really notice some of these. But, like, the U-Wing... I think it's a really interesting little addition.
Was the Hammerhead, too? Was that something?
That's actually from the Star Wars role-playing games.
That was originally awesome.
Where that came from. So that's actually, it's canon now, but it was from the other material.
Like, those guys just pushing the destroyer into each other.
I thought
it was
cool. It was like a reverse tugboat, or like a tugboat that could kill you or something. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but it was like they're going down. Like, they're not coming back.
Yeah.
Like, these are like suicide pilots. This is their design. Like, they're going to push and destroy these bigger ships. It's so powerful. It's such a powerful moment in the film when it all plays out. And
I think it's cool how they did it, too, where they do the ion torpedoes, so they knock out the power on it, then they hit it and push it. I was like, that's cool.
Yes.
They're thinking it out. They're thinking it through. And that's what...
All
the
dynamic in space, too. Because, like, a smaller ship like that could, push a bigger ship like that.
But, yeah, so technically that did exist. Like I said, Star Wars role-playing games, which, guys, if you're big D&D nerds, definitely try them out. I love those Star Wars role-playing games because I'm an uber nerd like that. Shake some dice. But, the U-Wings, I thought, were a really interesting addition. You see, they're transport for ground troops. They're like, okay, get the reinforcements down there. You see the U-Wings flying down, letting soldiers out and stuff. They made the fleet and the Rebel Army make actual military sense. You know what I mean? Like, everything they had there, it's like, yeah, you would need that on a battlefield. You need a ship that does that, you know?
Yep.
The way that it slides open perfectly. Like, let a bunch of troops in. And then, too, like, there's little things in the Death Troopers, which they're the stormtroopers that can aim. unless you have the Force, and the Force is with you, they can aim. They got cool black suits, and they may or may not be human. I actually did not get that inference until the second time watching it. You listen to their voices, and they actually might be droids. I wonder a little bit. Now, as I said, there's little curious things that you can kind of like. I'm sure they'll delve into them more. I know some people kind of question, like, well, hey, where were they in A New Hope? But it's, if they're supposed to be basically the Special Ops Secret Service crew of, like, the high-ranking officials, you wouldn't see tons of them. You know what I mean? You wouldn't.
No.
Unless they had them standing there in every single one of those little meetings while Vader's choking people, which they're just awful at their jobs then. Hey, is he choking our boss? Yeah, I think he's choking our boss. Nah, whatever. But yeah, so they did make new additions, and I thought the new additions blended extremely well.
Blended really well with the old stuff. Yeah.
And I think that people didn't notice some of the new things they did get from the movie. And just kind of more obsessing over, like, well, they're using X-Wings again. Oh, fan service.
Yeah, I think overall, I walked out of the theater, I said I like this film.
Yeah.
And I think... For a lot of people, people are doing that. They're walking out of it, like, I really like that film. They're afraid to say that they love this film. I'm going to say that. I think a lot of people are, and I'm saying it. I love this film. I think this is an amazing film. It's just it's a great movie. It's a great movie.
In some ways, I really like it better than The Force Awakens.
In some ways, I do as well. But some of the flaws. I mean, like, Force Awakens, you get John Williams and his score, the epicness that comes with it. I think a flaw for this one, Michael Giacchino, he didn't have very much time.
And that's why we didn't rag on him in this video, really. You guys got 4 weeks to make a score for a Star Wars film.
You're following, like, the greatest composer, arguably.
He had 2 weeks less to do this than they had to write Suicide Squad. Think about how little time that is.
Yeah. That was one of the first things I noticed in the movie, and I think a lot of people did too. You know, you don't have that classic John Williams score.
Yep.
And you feel it, you feel it, and I dock it, but you know, that's, again...
The first time, like, besides, okay, like, the title screen, the theme comes on, I'm like, nah, that's weak. But the first time I was in there, I didn't, when I was watching it, because we saw it on IMAX too, so I was like, oh, you know,
yeah,
the whole time.
Yeah, you gotta forget certain things.
Yeah, yeah, so I really wasn't keying in on the soundtrack. The second time around, though, especially in the opening scene, I was like, man, this
yeah,
isn't good. It was
kinda
like some like basic like soundtrack 101. But like I said, four weeks, I'm not gonna rag on him too hard for that. I couldn't have done better.
Yeah.
Sure.
What's a trend now though with Disney a little bit with Marvel and like now into this?
Yeah.
Their music is never really very prominent. I mean, at
mm-hmm.
least in the DC universe, you got Hans Zimmer.
Yeah, and they was the Giacchino they used again on Doctor Strange, right?
No.
Who was it?
I cannot remember.
But that was probably the most...
Oh, wait a minute, Giacchino.
That was probably the most prominent Marvel...
No, it wasn't Giacchino.
The guy that worked on Star Trek.
Oh, it was then.
Yeah, I'm pretty
so.
Sure, yeah. I was pretty sure it was Giacchino.
Yeah.
And it's probably the more prominent score of any Marvel movie that they've had.
Yeah.
So they're liking him over there with Disney. But yeah, I'm not gonna rag on the guy too hard. I really wonder what was wrong with Alexander Desplat's original score. But yeah, this definitely felt rushed.
That's not enough. And for me though, I'm a visual guy. I'm not gonna dock the movie too many points because the composer had
yeah.
4 weeks to do
just
it.
Just because I'm not gonna spin that, you know, in my car for months.
Yeah.
You know.
I think you know, some of the other flaws. For me, I think it's a little. I wouldn't say it's disjointed in the beginning, but it does move around a lot. And some of the pacing is a little slow. I'm fine with it.
Mm.
But I would dock it, dock it for that. But that's really my only complaints in this film.
So, that's been our kind of spoiler review rant. Look at it
rant.
However you'd like to. Us just on a talking freely here about Rogue One. But we did almost forget one thing. We mentioned the beginning. That Darth Vader scene, though. Holy shit. I'm an enormous Vader fan. Like,
yeah,
Vader's probably my favorite Star Wars character.
Greatest villain in cinema.
One of the. I know I was just doing a poll on Goat Movie Podcast where they had the Joker versus
yeah,
Darth Vader. I had to go with the Joker a little bit.
Many different ones, though.
But there's a little more there with the character.
There's a little more with the character, but there's only one James Earl Jones voiced Darth Vader.
Yes.
And honestly, when that first scene of him comes in the middle of the movie and you hear James Earl Jones, I mean, like...
Mm-hmm.
I can't even express in words like the feeling that I got from hearing that again.
It's like going home again.
God. It was like, yeah, it's like that's what I've been missing all my life.
Honestly, if you could just like speak to me as I fall asleep every day, that would be amazing.
Darth Vader.
Now you are falling asleep. Thank you, James Earl Jones. The first scene with him, I thought was pretty good. The choke on your ambition line was a little.
Aspirations.
Yeah, yeah, it was a little.
I was fine with it.
I felt like you know, it's like Vader. He's like, I just woke up. You know, I just got out of the BACTA. You know, he's kind of rolling with some of his B puns because he's a little punny in like the other movies. He thinks he considers himself witty, but he was definitely more witty in the way that Hayden Christensen would be witty than say, you know, James Earl Jones would be witty with that line. It wasn't the worst thing. I wasn't like, oh my god, throw this scene in the garbage. But I was kind of like, that's a little bit of his B material. He just woke up. Give him a break. I did like seeing him in the BACTA tank, though.
Yeah.
I know,
yeah.
like, my mom, who's not a big Star Wars fan, Gian took her to go see this as well, and she enjoyed it. And one of the things she said about some of the things that she saw from Vader is, like, she didn't realize those things about him. You know, even the first scene and the second. But the fact that he is this tortured being, his whole body, he barely can survive without doing that BACTA thing on the regular and without a breathing apparatus. I love, too, they show it. They just show you enough. Like, the mist kind of clears. You can see he's got no freaking
yeah,
arms.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
He's just like, you know.
A little bit of a RoboCop flashback.
Yeah, there you go.
He's barely a person in there.
Yeah. And it was cool kind of seeing behind the veil there with Vader. I was like, I think that's pretty cool. And I think some people forget about that he's, like, basically in this giant torture device, you know, all the time. He's just in constant pain, almost dying all the time, you know. And so it was cool to kind of, like, get to see his, like, his totally bitchin' castle, Which I was kind of wondering. I know that in continuity, it is on Mustafar. They don't say. You know, yeah, that's the one place they show the location. They don't say where that is. They're just like, look at this bitchin' castle. Metal as hell. It's the most metal place I've seen in a long time. It's almost as metal as like the places in the Lord of the Rings. Those bad guys. Those guys are extremely metal. Look at the hair too. But yeah, it was like, this is a pretty awesome castle here. I don't know why he'd want to go to the place where he got his dick burned off, but you know, they just saw maybe the property was cheap. But yeah, it was cool kind of seeing behind the veil with Vader. And then we get at the end of the movie another scene, which I think is kind of, it is the Batman warehouse scene from BVS of this movie, where it's like, we're getting to see.
You're finally getting to see what you've always wanted to see.
We get to see Darth Vader not just ice or kill or any, he massacres these rebels on his way to get the plans. It opens, they got all these guys.
It was directed so well. It was staged so well.
Yes.
Like you see the, like, everything goes silent. You see the darkness. You hear the breath, the iconic breathing, red saber, boom, glowing in the dark. You see him light up in it, and then him just, and then it was like, oh, I know what's gonna happen. I didn't know what was gonna happen. It was just kind of like my brain couldn't even create that scenario. And
he's redirecting blaster bolts with his hands, throwing guys like onto the roof. He's choking them out. He's slicing them. Dicing them.
Just the screams from the rebels too.
It turns into a little horror movie. He goes like Jason on them. You know, they're just like, oh my god, run! Freaking take the plans! Take them! I love that too. You see the lightsaber come through the door.
Like, through the guy. Like, it was, I mean, just thank you.
The sheer amount of shit in rebel pants that must have been in that scene. It must have smelled awful in there.
Oh,
it was just terrifying.
It awesome. It was just like, it was just kind of, I just want to sit and clap. Like, just.
Yeah, and you know, maybe, yeah, you could, you know, they're definitely servicing me as a fan.
Yeah.
But it was just like awesome.
But I think too, like, yeah, you're servicing fans, but like, you're also making the idea of Darth Vader accessible in 2016 because, I'm sorry, episode 4 doesn't do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you don't feel the same fear of Darth Vader.
And, you know, for, you know, my mom, who's, you know, well into middle age, it's like, for her, she'd never seen that character in that light. She never got it. And
she never
saw
Vader,
And so for, like, new fans or people that aren't as familiar to kind of get to see this character, who I said is one of my favorite characters, my favorite villains of all time, get to kind of see him and like, no, this guy is scary. He's not just some dude in a funny helmet.
Mm-hmm.
It's really easy to discount in that way. So it was cool to see him, now that we were able to, at full power, and just kind of see what he can do and just the real fear of a figure like Darth Vader. I like, too, that there is no lightsaber battles in this. It makes the Jedi or, like, you know, a Sith like that otherworldly.
Yes.
Like, holy shit, this is large, you know what
Again,
I mean?
Again, showing the contrast, you know, the rebellion, as the rebels would feel in that situation.
Yeah.
And it makes that scene even more powerful.
Yeah.
There isn't Luke Skywalker going to show up to save the day.
To save anybody.
No, those rebels are dying for what they're doing.
Yep.
And it's saving the world.
I thought it was integral to the film to have it there in the way that you're seeing the result of all of the sacrifice that the Rogue One team just did. They all sacrificed, laid down their lives, not just the Rogue One team, but all these rebels. Just gave their life for this cause, and you're actually seeing it. Okay, they got the plans there. You know what I mean? The hope is actually sparked there.
Yes.
You know, you see that, okay, they actually achieved their mission. I think that you couldn't have quite given it. It wouldn't have quite had that same kind of, that like, okay, I need to watch A New Hope now. Like, right now.
Yes, it wouldn't.
Because it really just leads it up there. It really ratchets it up where you're just like, okay, I'm ready. Just keep going.
Keep going.
So I thought it definitely had value, and then as just being a fan and just being selfish here, it was amazing to get something like that. See Vader, like, just being a badass. Is it wrong for me to like it? Tell me in the comments. So that's been our extra long video today about Rogue One. I hope you guys enjoyed listening with us. You can comment down below on your guys' thoughts. Did you think it was fan service? Did you guys love Rogue One? Let us know. Also, remember to like and subscribe. It really helps the channel out. You can also find us on Twitter at BacktotheFeature. We'll chat with you guys about Rogue One and other movies all day long. You can also find us on Facebook at Back to the Future. You can join us on our page there if you prefer Facebook over Twitter. Guys, until next time, I've been Giovanni Carlo.
And I'm John Vandaloo.
And may the Force be with you.
The Force will be with you. Always.